Hello, everyone, and I'd like to welcome you back to the 2017 Schooneman Symposium. This year's topic is challenging landscapes. So if you're here this afternoon, I think you're going to, in my opinion, be viewing an incredible treat. The first person who I'm here to introduce is someone I'm really excited about. A couple years ago, I was lucky enough to be a guest at the National Geographic Photo Seminar in Washington, D.C. And as you can imagine, you get to see some really amazing photos. And the work of this photojournalist who I'm going to introduce, to this day, I still see the images in my head. I told Bob that I really, really wanted to see if she was willing to come and share her work with all of us. So I'd like to introduce to you Evgenia Arbugaeva. I hope I pronounced that right. She's a freelance journalist, and she's from Tiksi, Russia. And if you are familiar with maps of the world, that's at the top of the country, very near the Arctic Circle. She frequently studies her Arctic homeland by discovering and capturing the remote worlds and the people who inhabit them. Her work has been exhibited internationally and has appeared in such publications as National Geographic, Mare, Le Monde, and The New Yorker. She's a graduate of the International Center of Photography's Documentary Photography and Photojournalism Program in New York City. She's a recipient of the ICP Infinity Award, the Leica Oskar Barnack Award, and the Magnum Foundation Emergency Fund Grant. So please welcome Evgenia.
Hello, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. And actually, this day is today and yesterday. Walking around campus, I realized how much I want to go back to school. And it's a really exciting, and I'm a bit jealous of all of you photography students, because this is the most, to my opinion, exciting time to be a student. And you probably think, oh, I'm struggling with like self-search and what am I going to become? But this is actually, I think, the most interesting and formative time, and at least it was for me. And when I graduated in 2009 from ICP, which is only 1 year program, I was in New York, and I was, you know, like many students after art school, kind of lost and didn't know what I want to do. And I was just taking pictures of kids for family albums mostly. And then I decided that, okay, I have to, I kind of almost gave up an idea of being a photographer. I thought it was so challenging, and I didn't know how I could make it into the photography world. And I decided that I'm just going to go back to my homeland, because this is where I wanted to go, regardless if I'm a photographer or not. Because as Tim mentioned, I was born in a very special place. It's called Tiksi, and it's right on the shore of Arctic Ocean in Russia, in eastern Siberia. And it's back in the Soviet time. It was built as an important military base during Cold War, and there was it was a secret town. So until this day, you cannot actually enter. You have to obtain the FSB permit and all of this. And my parents went to Tiksi when they were young, madly in love with each other, exploring this new land. And at that time, Arctic in Soviet Union was kind of, to go to work in the Arctic was almost like flying to the moon. There was this idea of northern explorations, and they went, and I was born there. And I had a very happy childhood. And at that time, Arctic ideas were used in cartoons and children's books and films, and you are always kind of surrounded by it. And my favorite cartoon called Magic Flower, and the protagonist of the cartoon is a girl called Genia, which is my name as well, a short form of my name. And I'll just want to show you this little episode from this cartoon. So she has this magic flower, and then she can take a petal and make a wish, and her wish will come true. And she made a wish to go to the North Pole.
Лети, лети, лепесток, через запад на восток, облети вокруг земли, быть, по-моему, вели. Вели, чтоб я сейчас же была на Северном полюсе.
Я тебя, девочка, съем!
Ой, мамочка!
So, Genia from the cartoon needed a magic flower to get herself to the South Pole, and I was kind of already there, and I was thinking, at the time, I remember even being a kid, I realized how much of a special place it is and felt lucky that I'm there. And I remember every Sunday, there was a program by Jacques Cousteau, who is my absolute hero. And I would watch his programs and imagine that I'm Jacques Cousteau and dreaming of times when I will join Calypso ship and go explore the world. And this is my favorite film that he produced was The Voyage to the Edge of the World, where he went to Antarctica and flew above the ice on this fantastic balloon, air balloon. And that kind of those landscape kind of also reminded me of things that I have in my backyard. And I would, gather my friends and we would play expeditions on the shore of the Arctic Oceans. And of course, I was the leader of the expedition, Jacques Cousteau. And, but then in 1991, there was a fall, it was a fall of Soviet Union, and my country had lots of things to deal with, and they stopped to finance its northern project. And basically there was like everybody, my parents were teachers, and they stopped getting salary, everything stopped, and people started to pack and move to other cities, and they boarded their windows and just moved. It was very fast, so the population of Tiksi from 12,000 people, now it's only 4,000 people living there. And I thought, with time, I was missing Tiksi a lot. I was missing this really ideal little world of mine with aurora borealis and the vastness of tundra and the winds and all that. And as it usually happens with memories, they kind of start to transform into some surreal images. And I was wondering if I'm actually making it up, or does this place really exist? And I asked my mom, like, is it true that the whole sky was like pink or green? And is it true that the winds are so strong that I felt like I'm flying, the wind picks me up, and I'm going to random places? And my mom was like, yeah, it's kind of true, but you're kind of making it up at the same time. So I decided to, after ICP, 19 years later, I decided to go back to Tiksi. And when I arrived, I found this place completely different from how I remember it. It's now it's an almost abandoned town. And as you can see on this picture, you know, all the windows are closed and there's not many people on the streets. And I was really sad. I remember I was wandering around town and thinking, okay, this is, you know, why did I come? I shouldn't be coming back here. And then I met this girl, her name is Tanya, she's on the left. And she's a very special girl. She's very adventurous, she's really fun, and she sees Tiksi kind of like I saw it when I was a kid. So here, Tanya with her best friend, Pasha. This is just before Christmas in Russia, we have this tradition of dressing up and going around houses, singing songs, and getting treats in advance, kind of in exchange, kind of like your Halloween. This is Tanya in her snow mask. This is, and I wore the same mask when I was a kid. And she was saying she loved wearing this mask, and she was saying that she feels like astronaut on Neptune. And she also loves that. She always was singing or talking very loud when she was wearing this mask because she's like, I love this echo inside. And it's actually for protecting the face from the snowstorms. I mean, wind can get really, really strong. It can get to 28 kilometers per second. And then we went exploring different places. She showed me around town, and sometimes we had to walk for, you know, close to 10 kilometers. But it all worth it because we would discover a castle of weather magician, for example, and we're just wandering around as a snowstorm started to pick up. And as it turned out, Tanya is also a fan of Jacques Cousteau, and she wears the red hat as a tribute to her hero. Her dad gave her a full DVD collection of Jacques Cousteau for Christmas, and we were rewatching it when I was there. This is my playground. When I was a kid, I was playing here and imagining myself as an astronaut. And in fact, it's kind of strange because all children playground in Tiksi, they're all made of they're all rockets, because there was this kind of strange obsession with space and Arctic, and it was all kind of, and you kind of feel like you're on a different planet in Tiksi because everything is so flat, like a moon surface. During Soviet time, Tiksi was an important seaport on the route of Northeast Passage. And I remember, you know, there were so many ships coming in during summer all the time. But now it's not functioning anymore. Although now with global warming, Russia is looking into it again, not only Russia, but the whole world, because now, you know, the season for navigation is getting longer and longer and longer. And all people who live in Tiksi, they're hoping that, you know, life will come back to the seaport. And here, Tanya is playing Titanic. Sometimes snowstorms could last for 3 days, 4 days, sometimes a week. So people in Tiksi always have food enough to sustain them for a week. And then you just don't go out of house for several days. And in times like that, it's quite boring. So we were just, you know, playing games and playing ballerinas, of course, dancing at home. And this is one of those days. I was really amazed by the way Tanya sees the light and the colors, because there's not much to look at in Tiksi. It's, as I said, it's very flat, and during winter it's always dark, during summer it's always light because it's above Arctic Circle. And after the dark winter, people get really excited about the sun. And this is February, the month, like it was already maybe 2 weeks that the sun appeared. And one day Tanya told me, let's go to see mountain made of blueberry ice cream. And I was like, okay, what is that? She's like, but we have to go at 4 p.m. So we went, and she's like, see, I told you. This is like, it looks just like blueberry ice cream, this pink color. And I was just so amazed how she noticed this. And she knew exactly the time. And then, so she was helping me a lot with photography because she would tell me, I'm like, okay, so tell me more. What other places should we explore? So she was my guide. This is a playground. Well, this is actually former military training ground. But Tanya said that one day she said, let's go to the playground made of matches. And when we arrived, I was like, okay, yeah, it kind of does look like matches. And it's kind of dangerous too for kids to play. I mean, but local kids come here all the time. Then another time, Tanya and her sister told me, let's go to this gigantic TV antenna. And we arrived there, I'm like, girls, this is not a TV antenna. In fact, this is like a locators for, you know, back from Cold War. And I photographed this antenna for so many times. I don't know, I probably have, I don't know, close to, I don't know, 50 versions of this. But I knew that it has to be a good picture. I really wanted it in the story, but it just kind of didn't work. And one day we went, and Tanya had this LED light, flashlight, torch, and her sister had like this normal tungsten light. And then the aurora borealis just started on the background, and there was a nice light from the city. And finally, the picture happened. This is the strong snowstorm. And here, I didn't know actually that I'm gonna get a picture because I didn't see anything. And I thought, okay, the only way to get it is, you know, to use flash. So I'm on the ground kind of trying to take a picture, but I don't see anything. I was just hoping that somebody would pass by or something's gonna happen. And it happened. This is New Year night, and I'm coming back home after a party that I had together with the local meteorologist. And, and you know, like, Russians obviously like to drink a lot. And you hear, like, I wish there was a sound from every door. There's, like, people singing songs, music playing. And then I stumbled upon this dog. And I didn't have a camera with me. I was like, oh, I need to take this picture. But I lived like two floors up. So I tiptoed by the dog, went up, took a camera. Then I'm like, no, it's too dark. I need a tripod. I went back again, took a tripod, tiptoed back, set up my laptop, my tripod, the camera. I took a picture, like lots of pictures. And this dog didn't open one eye. I think he was really drunk. This is near Seaport, and this is an old lighthouse. But Tanya said that this is a spaceship. When she saw the picture, she's like, oh, this is a spaceship. But then she couldn't decide if it's landing or it's taking off. And this is her and her sister. Summertime, June, actually end of June, yeah. And it's at the sea. And this was a really beautiful day. And Tanya was, I was like, okay, let's go for a walk. Maybe I can take pictures of you and the ice. And she really wanted to wear this dress because she was worried that that she's at that time she was already 13 and she was growing so fast. She's like, please take a picture of me with this dress. I think I'm going to grow out of it like tomorrow. So we were just walking around, and then there was this dog following us. There's actually a lot of homeless dogs in Tiksi, because in 1991, when everybody left, they didn't take their dogs with them. And there's like, you know, a whole community of these dogs, and they really want to have an owner, so they just follow you. This is at the meteorological station. And this woman, her name is Irina, and she was here. She lives in Tiksi already for more than 20 years. She's from St. Petersburg, and she arrived to Tiksi, and she fell in love with the place and stayed. And her job is to let go of a weather balloon once a day. This is all she does. She just goes out in the open tundra and let it go. And she loves her job. And I was asking her, I was curious to see how many thousands of balloons she had let go in her life. We tried to calculate, but then she's like, I don't think it's possible, because I don't remember how many sick leaves I had, how many vacation time. So we couldn't. But I thought it would be such a perfect caption. Like, Irina, meteorologist, she let go of like 25,000 balloons in her lifetime. And then the other interesting character is Uncle Vanya, who I was just walking along the coast, and then I stumbled upon this weird shack, and it says, the sign says banka, which means bathing house in Russian. and then he came out, and we became friends instantly. And actually then I was like, did you live in this house, on this and this floor? He's like, yeah. And I remembered he was my neighbor, and I was terrified of him. I never dared to talk to him, because he had doves, and in summer he would let them go, and they would flip and turn. You know, he would whistle and clap his hands, and they would, you know, do like different figures in the air and all this. And I thought he's some kind of a dark magician. And he's kind of a strange character, but he's very kind. And somehow in Russia we say about these people kind of being touched by a person that been touched by God, which means kind of a person who is, you know, lives in his perfect world, very naive. So local people can be especially like teenagers, are very cruel to him. They come to this shack and destroy it once in a while, but he doesn't, he's like, oh, they're just kids, you know, and he puts it back together. And he's actually, he's a writer. He's a regular contributor to the local newspaper, which called the Lighthouse of the Arctic. And he writes stories and about how to raise a family, how to be a good husband. He never had a family. His only friend is this dog. But he comes, and this shack is where he writes. This is his office. This is where he writes these articles. And this is his apartment. He's also an artist. Check out this painting with the polar bear and walrus eating ice cream. And you see the dried mushrooms that he collected in tundra probably like 10 years ago. And he likes music. And he said, okay, I'm gonna play trombone for you. And he started playing, and the cloud of dust came out. And I missed that moment, which was, yeah. One day, Tanya told me that she can be invisible. And this is like a classic weather in Tiksi in winter. Overcast sky, and this is what I really love about Tiksi, is that sky gets so white and snow is so white that you don't see the difference between sky and the land, and you kind of feel like you're in space zero, like you're in some vacuum. And she borrowed this camouflage hunting costume from her dad, and she was running on the lake and sliding, and I seriously couldn't see her. Well, I could only see her mittens, her red mittens. This is Uncle Vanya fishing in summer. He fishes just for himself, but mostly for a dog. On the way, we were walking in tundra, and then we were coming back to town. And back in the day when I lived in Tiksi, all these houses were really bright colors. Now they're kind of all faded. Because when you live in the Arctic, there's this dangerous thing of color starvation. So people tend to paint houses really bright and wear bright clothes. This is also in the seaport, old barge. And here, Tanya already turns 14, and she starts to have some misunderstandings with her family, with her parents. And this is the place where she comes to kind of regain her inner peace and drops the stones in the water. Tanya in her room, I was talking to her, telling her something, and then I turned around and I keep talking to her, and then I turned back again and she was sleeping. And I looked at her for some time, and I realized that she's growing up, that she's not a little girl anymore. And I felt that maybe this is when I should stop the story, where I should stop to photograph, because I think that the reason why I came to Tiksi is to kind of close this childhood channel that was kind of so abruptly cut when we moved. And then I made a decision that that's enough, because I was working on this for 2 years. I was coming back to Tiksi for a couple of weeks, sometimes 3 weeks. And when I said to Tanya that I finished and I'm going to go back, she was really sad because we became really good friends, and we're still really good friends. She's actually now goes to college, and she's a freshman in college, and she's going to be a heart surgeon. And she's really smart. She's amazing. And when I told her the day when I was leaving, she said, "Okay, well, I can't sleep. I couldn't sleep either, and it was 4 a.m. And she's like, "Let's go for a walk." We went for a walk, and it was really foggy outside. And she said, "Let's climb the mountain, the only mountain that there is. It's not really a mountain, it's a hill." And we went up the hill. It was still really cloudy. And then all of a sudden, the clouds started to disappear, and this golden light appeared, and we were laying on the ground, and I was just saying goodbye to Tanya and to Tiksi. Then I'll show you another project that I did in the Arctic. I was always fascinated by meteorological stations. So there is this, I don't know, well, probably many of you know, there is this time space that exists on our planet that is not connected to any time zones, which is a meteorological time. So in this particular, every particular hour and minute of this meteorological time, meteorologists around the world come out at the same second and record the climate, temperature, pressure. And so our planet is kind of wrapped with this system grid of meteorological stations. And some of them are really remote. And I was wondering, I always dreamt to visit Arctic meteorological stations, because I knew that there are some stations that are located on islands that are just, you know, 3 kilometers wide, and there are two or even one person living there for years. And at the time, I got into a workshop called Jupe's Ward. It's in Amsterdam. It's for young photojournalists. And I decided to use this opportunity and cover that story. And the only way I could do that is to go on the icebreaker that delivers supplies to this hard-to-reach meteorological stations. So I wrote the letter to this Arctic advisor of Putin saying that, you know, I'm a photographer, I'm a young photographer, I'm from Tiksi, and I really want to go on board of icebreaker. And I didn't hope for any reply. I got a reply, and he's like, hey, I worked in Tiksi for a long time. Sure, you know, get on board. Like, leave, like, in 2 weeks. Like, okay. So, when I work on the project, I like to build kind of reference board. It's kind of how filmmakers work. And I love painting, European painting of 19th century, that era of, you know, when they were depicting these great explorers of the Arctic or other unknown lands. And this is, for me, this painting represents so much of that fascination and the landscape, really, and the smallness of a person, but also the will. And I looked a lot at them while working on this project. I looked a lot at the paintings to kind of understand the aesthetics. And I think it comes across a lot in this project. Like, for example, with Tiksi, I was looking a lot at the cartoons and the children's books. And that's why the composition is rather simplistic and very central. Kind of resembling, and the colors are really bright, kind of resembling cartoons and illustrations. So I looked at some films about first explorers of the Arctic, meteorologists. So this is a station, it's a screenshot from the film, one of the first meteorological stations in the Arctic. One of my favorite films, Two Captains, this film from the 50s where a man went in search for the lost expedition. This is another picture from the film of this researchers that were stranded in this faraway meteorological station. But you'll understand, I'll tell you later why I'm showing this picture here. They brought this bird with them, a singing bird, and they're all the birds in the polar night became the center of their station because they really missed something, you know, alive and warm. This is the ship that I went on board on, but this is a picture from 50s. It's a very old heroic icebreaker. It went to Antarctica and was stranded in the ice, and now it's really in bad condition, and it works in the Arctic, delivering supplies to meteorological stations. So I spent 2.5 months on board. This is my view. And the cafeteria was really bad on board, but we were given oranges once a week, and then I would on weekend, on Sunday. And then on Sunday, I would hear knocks and sailors would give me the orange as a present. So I had this collection of oranges. So I visited 22 stations. And the one that fascinated me the most was in this small peninsula in Barents Sea called Hadavariha. It's very, very narrow. You can literally walk from one shore to another in 30 minutes. And I met the chief of the station. His name is Slava. And when I first saw him, I instantly recognized his jacket. This is the kind of jacket that all men would wear in Tiksi. And he's this representation of the long-lost era of Arctic explorers, kind of this old Arctic wolves that sacrificed their life for Arctic exploration. These are the men who kind of, you know, who read Hemingway and lead solitary life. They're the dreamers. And I don't think this generation doesn't exist anymore, really, because when I went to the meteorological stations, There are some young scientists now, but they're all with their laptops, satellite phones. And for me, Slava, he's there. Of course, he's doing his research, but he's there also because he's so in love with the land. And also, he's not able to really live in the city, in our society, because he doesn't... He says that, why everybody's running around? I don't understand. I don't understand why when I'm in the city, I have to follow the, you know, certain path. Why I cannot cross the road wherever I want? In tundra, I can walk wherever I want. I'm completely free. He doesn't understand, you know, the... our rush for, you know, for money, for career, and all this. He thinks it's really not important. So in that sense, he's kind of a Zen monk. So on when I just arrived to the station, it was in summer, and I could only stay for 1 hour. And when I met Slava, I realized, okay, this is a really special person, and I'll have to come back. So in winter, I got a grant, and I hired my own helicopter to fly there. And I decided to do it on New Year Eve. So I bought some oranges, champagne, and flew there. And I couldn't let him know that I'm coming because the radio signal was really bad. And they didn't hear from him for a really long time. So I thought, okay, I'll just fly and show up there. And when I landed, kind of, you know, the helicopter is still working. It's really loud. And I'm screaming, like, do you mind if I'll stay here for a couple of weeks? He's like, sure. And I stayed. And this is the first day I arrived, actually. It was a beautiful full moon. And there is this old lighthouse, which is now used as a firewood. And so Slava is now walking to the lighthouse he kind of disassembles it slowly for wood. So there is no really sense of time in the station because it's always dark. So this is winter, so sun never shows itself. And I felt like it all felt like one long night. And the only way I could feel the time is by hearing Slava's steps going out every 3 hours to take measurements. And then he would come back to his office and record the data in this old yellowed by time journal. This is a meteorological field, a booth with thermometers. And when he went to record the temperature, all of a sudden, aurora started, kind of exploded in the sky. And I took the picture, and at that moment, it felt like he's turning the knob. He's turning on the aurora borealis. To me, he became kind of a weather magician who speaks with the wind and can light the stars. So that still from the film that I showed you with the bird, along with oranges and champagne, I brought a bird as a Christmas present. And Slava was very happy, and it's his friend now. And he's talking to the bird every day. And there's one detail that I noticed only after I was back already. There's this onion growing. And usually when you grow something, it kind of grows towards the light, towards the window. But here, it grows towards him. One day, I felt quite heavy and depressed because nothing really goes on. And I came to Slava, and he doesn't really talk much. He told me, he's like, I wish I could talk to you, but I'm so used to talking in my own head that it's so foreign to me to put things into words. And one day I was like, okay, We gotta talk, please. How do you live here? Like, every day is the same. There's nothing happens. And he said, are you crazy? Every day is so different. Today you saw this phenomenon of thin ice on the water. You know how rare this is? Then look at the sky. The clouds are completely different. Pressure dropped. The snowstorm is coming. It dropped so much that it's probably going to be the strongest storm that you've seen so far. How can you say that every day is the same? And from that moment, I thought that, you know, I was so embarrassed of myself to be so kind of surfacey. And I started to try to see everything through his eyes and to take a notice on little things in the weather. So this is how he starts his day, kind of looking out the window. He has lots of free time. So he's building this little houses made of matches. This is the only means of communication, the old radio. And sometimes when the radio signal is really low during snowstorm, he still uses Morse code, actually, which is so, I mean, like, who uses Morse code now? And when he communicates with the main office to deliver data every 3 hours, they don't even ask the questions like, how are you? No, he just says his code number, his code name, and then the rest goes with just in numbers, temperature, pressure, and so on. This was a really nice day. It was so calm and quiet, and it's very rare, actually, for this area. And Slava is enjoying his cigarette in a handmade boat. He says that he actually chose this station because he could choose from different locations. Actually, it's very easy to choose because every station almost in the Russian Arctic are understaffed, and nobody wants to work there. And he picked this peninsula because he was born on the ship. His mom was a cook and his dad was an engineer. So all his childhood he spent on the ship. And he says that in this peninsula he feels like he's on this gigantic ship because he is surrounded by water and he can hear the ocean all the time. Last image from this project, view from the house. And this is in the middle of polar night. And I was actually thinking that how am I going to photograph in the darkness? But really there are so much different shades and there is light that creates this really interesting colors. And it's very special. I haven't seen these colors anywhere else in the world. The latest project that I did was actually in Africa. I'm going to show you quickly. I was participating in a conference, anthropological conference in Oslo, and one anthropologist told me that he's working on this really interesting project in Tanzania where about this abandoned research station, malaria research station, in the middle of lush forest in Usambara Mountains. And he said that he's studying dreams and nostalgia. And I thought, well, this sounds like my type of project. And so as I was learning more about the story, I thought I was more and more interested. And then I went together with anthropologists to Africa, actually my first time. So Amani is a station that was established by German colonists before World War II. They arrived and they built coffee plantations and botanical gardens. And then after World War II, British came and they built this malaria research station. And at that time, Africa was considered as living laboratory, and you know, lots of discoveries were made, and British scientists came and they established their own kind of little perfect world. But then after independence of Tanzania, they left, and now this place is almost abandoned. And I met John Mganga, who used to be an assistant to this famous British scientist. And he became a protagonist of my story. He showed me around the forest. He was showing me how, here he is showing me how he was catching bugs for research. This is a collection of insects that he gathered together with the British scientist. Inside the lab. So John is retired and he doesn't have to come to the station, but he comes almost every day, takes care of the specimens in the jar, dusts the shelves, sweeps the floor. There's also a colony of white mice. There is a person who's still, everybody call him Mouse Man. He's taking care of this mice, but there is no research going on, so I don't know, it's been like this for years, but he still keeps doing it, so there's lots of mice. And these keepers of the station, they have nothing to do, so most of the time they sleep or talk to each other inside the lab. So these are the remains of German Botanical Garden. As I was walking around at night, I saw this signs in Latin, which seemed to me some kind of, you know, phrases from some Latin spell. When British scientists first came to Tanzania, local people were calling them mumiani, which in Swahili means vampires, because they were coming at night to the villages to collect samples of their blood for malaria research, and locals thought that they're doing it to perform their sinister rituals. And actually, John told me that his peers tried to kill him many times because he was assistant of mumiani. Here's a picture of, this is one of the things that they were doing every day. Yeah, I apologize for the quality of the images. It's a bit strange. But so here he's showing me how they were doing this, they were feeding mosquitoes. So local people would come to the lab and they would be paid like very small money and they would hold their hand for hours and feed the mosquitoes in the cage. And it's a strange place. It feels like time stopped there, but at the same time, all the assistants, local assistants who used to work there, for them, science was so big, and they loved to belong to something bigger than them, and they really hope that scientists will come back one day. That's it.
So does anyone have any questions?
You have a question?
I'm going to be like the geeky guy that asks about technical stuff. Can you talk a little bit about the challenges technically of working in Arctic? And specifically, what kind of gloves do you recommend?
I always wear thin silk gloves and a fur mittens inside, double layers, because batteries die really fast in low temperatures, so I keep, you know, three batteries in each mitten usually, and then three here in the pocket, and three here in another pocket, because sometimes when the temperature drops to minus 40 Celsius, the one battery can last you only 10 shots. I keep my camera kind of, I wear two coat, big parka and then a thinner coat inside, and I keep my camera between my coats usually. And the most challenging thing is that you have to kind of make an image before you actually take a camera. So I kind of frame it and compose the image and then quickly take the camera and take a picture, which is kind of a nice thing, actually. I think it kind of prevents you from overshooting. Yeah, but the main challenge is condensation. So I use two cameras, one for inside and one for outside. Never bring camera from cold to warm. Yeah, but otherwise, well, tripod. It's cold. When you cool the shutter, you push the shutter, you can't do it with the fur mittens. So, but in silk gloves, you kind of, yeah. And then your nose kind of gets stuck to the back because you breathe, and then you take picture, and if you take for too long, you kind of, you know, there's ice between you and the camera. Yeah.
Another question.
This is a non-technical question, just curiosity. The shot with I forgot the name of the man at the station with the lighthouse. What time of day or night? I love that light, the color. So I was just curious at what time of day or night produces that kind of color.
It was probably around 10 p.m., but it doesn't really matter during polar night because it's always dark. But the special light created by full moon, and I kind of planned my trip to the moon phase to have the moon, and because in the darkness of polar night, moon and aurora are the only sources of light. Yeah, and it's really the colors are so subtle, and that's what interests me about polar night mostly. Yeah.
What landscape or I think story are you interested in exploring next?
Next?
Yeah.
I'm going back to the north because I felt a couple of years ago I thought that, you know, maybe I'm good only in photographing in the Arctic because that's my comfort zone, that's what I know. So I had my tropical period. I went to Tanzania and now I'm finishing a story for Geographic, actually, about butterfly catchers in Indonesia. And I haven't seen snow for a really long time. And actually, I found myself not long ago, for breakfast, I was served this kind of white, kind of like in Russia we have, it's kind of like cottage cheese on the white plate with the white yogurt on top. And I was looking inside this plate, and I was like, I want to be there. So I think it's time to go back to the Arctic for me, for sure.
I had a question. Can you offer any advice as to what it was like going to these very remote places as a female where only one or two men were? Do you have any advice about that?
I never think of the... obviously, I think there is more... I don't like to think of this, really. And I, to me, to be honest, I know that communities for women photographers or prize for women photographers, but I think I'm a photographer, and it's really not, in the end of the day, it just matters who you are as a person. And I think it's just I when I arrive somewhere, I just let everybody know. I mean, you have to kind of set yourself so people respect you, and but I think it's just you have to kind of intuitively know how to behave. So I never had really an issue with that. I did this story about mammoth hunters, people who dig out the mammoth tusk in this really remote Arctic island, and there was about 100 men on the island, and I was the only woman. And I knew that I have to position myself as a friend and as a sister, rather than, you know, a woman. But it's kind of comes naturally, and you know, you just talk to people and being really honest. If you don't like something, you just say, you know, if you don't like how somebody talks to you, you just say, don't talk to me like this. But in also not like hysterical way, but just like straight and, you know. But I think it can happen with, yeah, I think it's really about personality, not the gender so much. And we were actually talking with Caitlin about working in the magazine, because I'm doing now on my fifth story of for Geographic, and how, you know, different approaches of the editors, and I feel like I never felt like I've been assigned to something because I'm a woman, or I've been, you know, and yeah, I don't think it matters really.
Anyone else? Okay.
Right. What have been the outcomes of your work on the nostalgia pieces?
Please use the microphone that our remote audience can hear you.
Thank you. What have been the consequences of some of your stories, particularly those dealing with the nostalgia of former research locations in the north, the Tanzania former research center. Did it have any policy outcomes? Did anything change?
Well, I have to say that this is not about, it's not about the decay of the malaria research in Tanzania. I mean, the station was relocated now, and it's now based in the bigger town. The reason why it was abandoned in this particular location is that when British came, they didn't like the heat, obviously. And there is this thing of, you know, hilltop stations that were practiced in India and elsewhere in their colonies. So malaria research is still thriving in Tanzania. So yes, I suppose I will have to, you know, get this message across. And it's not about the failure, really. It's about dreams of science on both sides, from local assistants and the British scientists.
Yeah. A lot of your photos seem to have a pretty distinct look to them, and I know that's at least in part due to the location where you were, but where do you, have you drawn inspiration for your style, your photographic style?
I showed you a bit of the cartoon and then some references from the paintings. Also, when I work on the story, my own story, I usually just try to isolate myself from everything else, but just kind of work on my bubble. Really, because it takes a lot of work to create a bubble, and I do it by listening to a certain type of music. Like with Slava, for example, I was really into cello music, and where the cello is a prime instrument. Then, you know, I spend a lot of time in the museums in front of the paintings, hours and hours, just trying to understand the magic of composition. I read literature that is connected to the atmosphere that I want to create. Mostly, I'm a fan of magical realism literature. Gabriel Garcia Marquez is my hero. When he died in 2014, I was crying for a week. Because I was like, I read all your books. How can you die now? I need new stuff to read. Yeah, but I think I like my younger brother. He's a filmmaker, and we collaborate actually a lot now. And when he works on the films, he has, you know, this references and you know how filmmakers they cut the film from already existing material, like inspirational material, just to kind of understand how the film will be holding. And I'm kind of doing the same with my stories. So I have a board where I pin all the things that inspire me, and yeah.
When you're out in the field with one or two other people for a couple weeks, how do you stay inspired? Do you have that stuff with you? Do you bring the art and books with you?
Well, it's not like I have to constantly look at it. I think that it's just that, you know, when you're working on the story, I think for me it's important. For me, the process starts like I have to have at least three images. Once I know that I made these three images that, you know, hold together aesthetically and, you know, atmospherically, then I'm just building up on these three images. It's always three somehow. And then once, you know, I photograph a lot. I mean, for the stories, both Tiksi and Weatherman, I can do 10 different stories. It could be about a story, a journalistic investigation about the poor state of meteorological research in Russia. It can be a story of a, you know, depressing, lonely man, and can be a story of, you know, because there is also a military base not far from the station that I photographed a lot as well. It can be a story about that. But as I was photographing and looking at my photographs I usually look at my photographs every day, every night after shooting. And I feel like, okay, this is not it. And then once the picture comes, that is it. And then another one and another one, then it's kind of gives me an idea of how it's going to go. And then for me, it's also important to choose the color palette. And I think it's also a similar process for the filmmaking, because, you know, they have like this, they create these color palettes for the films. And especially in Wes Anderson films, for example, it's very prominent. And so for me, yeah, it's important to find a color thread. And then once I find it, then I don't have to photograph so much. It's kind of a relief because I kind of stopped searching everywhere. Now I'm more focused. And then I like to, when I have these three images, I prefer to come back, analyze it, you know, create this bubble, and then come back again. But it's also, it's very much about, you know, my protagonist. It's very, all the stories are character-driven, and a lot of it is their world, and I'm just trying to see and listen to them, really.
Anyone else?
A question in the back.
Okay.
For most of your nighttime pictures, like the first picture of the weatherman, did you have your own lights to bring, or did you just use natural light?
I didn't have any lights. Yeah, it's all natural light. It's a lot of long exposure, and many times the frostbite, because you have to hold it. Yeah, because I should get this remote thing, remote control. But I just keep like keeping the shutter, and if you keep the shutter open for, you know, 3 minutes, sometimes I do 3-4 minutes exposures. I just go like this, and I stand there. Ah, it's freezing.
Do we have any more questions? Yeah. Yes.
You're wonderful.
Thanks.
This is my wife. This is my wife. I love her deeply. I love you too. My question will sound silly, and I don't want you to think it's silly. I have great respect for you and your work. In some ways, you seem very childlike, your face, your body, and kind of like Peter Pan a little bit. And there's a little, I know you research your stories, or in your hometown, you went back to a place familiar. When you go to a totally unfamiliar place, do you do heavy research, or do you arrive and let it happen to you? I ask this because one of the things that worked for me is being naive, coming into a place, just not knowing what to expect, not being prepared, because I feel if you come so heavily prepared, then you will photograph what you came to see instead of seeing what you came to. Does that make sense?
It does. And I'm glad that I was able to fool you into my naivety. It does. And the reason why I showed this three stories today is because it's not drastically different, but it's very different from the assignment work that I do for National Geographic, for example. When I work for the magazine, it's a whole different game, of course. But at the same time, it has to be well researched, and all of my stories are very well researched. But for editorial work, I can't afford to kind of just drift. But the latest story, actually, that I was really pleased and thankful for to an editor that I'm working with now at Geographic, the story of butterfly catchers. When we were discussing the story, she said to me, just be yourself, do exactly what you do on your own work. Don't think that it's a magazine work. Don't think about your audience. Don't just do what you do. And I said, okay, I'm moving to Indonesia then. And I did for some time because I thought that I cannot possibly make a story about the place without living there or spending enough time to understand, because then it wouldn't be fair to the country or to these people. Even for Tanzania, for example, of course, it's a story about this magic and nostalgia and memories, but to being able to afford to tell this story that is not so reality-based, I have to study the reality first. So I went to Tanzania and I lived in the station for 3 months on my own, kind of just, you know, spending time in the old library, wandering around, being bored the same way as these people are bored. And then slowly pick up this wave of this certain atmosphere I want to capture. So I'm a photographer, and I understand very well that it's a genre of photography, you know, it's the same way as magical realism is a genre in literature. But it's true that it takes, you know, a certain kind of mindset that I had when I was a kid, and I hope I still have. But it takes work to sustain it because, you know, we're all growing up.
And what do you want to be when you grow up?
Well, actually, I think I just want to be who I am right now, because I still can't believe that I'm getting paid for this, you know? it's just a miracle to me that I can do what I do. And this also, like, right now, professionally, I think I'm in a very interesting position because my work exists as a documentary work, as in, you know, in magazines and newspapers, because it's very documentary based, but it also exists in the art world. Like I have, you know, galleries that represent my work, and I sell prints. So, and both of these branches of my career are important and almost, you know, have the same weight in my life. So that's, yeah, but no, I'm not just like this girl who, like, oh, everything is magical, chick, chick. No.
Evgenia, I'm going to jump in here and say, because I want you guys to know what a badass she is. Do you want to tell us the geographic stories you've done, what topics they've been on?
Yeah, well...
your story titles. Like, we had a big... The big story we had on infrastructure in the Arctic and engineering in the Arctic.
Well, yeah, like, I work... The first story that I did for Geographic is about this people who excavate mammoth tusks in the... this remote island in the Arctic Ocean. And this is the first time that when I got the assignment. Yeah, so we had to, as I mentioned, there was like all this man, and then we had to, I lived with them for 2 months on the island. I had to cross the ocean, this small boat, you know, starving for weeks together with these people, you know, killing seagulls just to eat and all that. Then I did a story about Arctic resources where I photographed this major gas fields and gold mines in northern Canada, in Russia. Then I did a story this summer migrating with the Nenets reindeer herders, and it's a story about the biggest gigantic gas field that is now taking over this peninsula of Yamal, the homeland of this Nenets people. Yeah, so... And the butterflies. Butterflies is like, it sounds fun, but you actually have to sit in the jungle for hours and hours, wait for butterflies. And the butterflies are so small. Like, how are you going to make a picture of, like, catching? You know, it's just, it's very challenging. And yeah, and you have to sit in the jungle and wait for butterflies for weeks. Yeah, but it's all, I mean, it all takes, like, as one of the photographers in your video said, good stories take time, you know? It's like, with Slava, like sometimes also people ask me, like, okay, so your compositions and your personal work are so perfect and it looks kind of like almost a stage photographs. But this project, each of them, like Weatherman, for example, it's only 12 images total. Like, I don't release more than 12 images. And it took me 1 year to do this. So yeah, it takes a lot of time.
Please join me in thanking Evgenia Arbugaeva again.
Thank you. Thanks.